Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The John Stone Action Pack, Books 4 through 6, Military Action Thriller Series, by Alan Manning and Brian Manning. Narrated by Roger Wayne. Head of the Serpent, by Alan Manning and Brian Manning. Chapter 1. 8 months had passed since the United States government decommissioned the Hostile Response Division. Under the supervision of the U.S. military and critical personnel in the Department of Homeland Security, the HRD was a joint task force, responsible for combating domestic threats with international ramifications. Price Windham was one such man, attempting to acquire a prototype weapon capable of defeating the most sophisticated encryption to engage in cyber warfare. Price was on the verge of shifting the balance of power in the global theater of war, selling his talents to the highest bidder. Recruited by the HRD at that time, John Stone lent his talents to the team to track down and stop Windham. For John, it went beyond the mission. He had a personal stake in the matter, tracking down the men responsible for murdering his friend, Frank Colt, and kidnapping his goddaughter, Emily. During that time, John found himself accused of committing acts of domestic terrorism. The Secretary of Defense relieved Marvin Van Pierce, the director of the Hostile Response Division, of command. The Hostile Response Division took on a new mission: find and capture John Stone. On the run and hunted by two opposing forces, John eventually stopped Price Windham, revealing evidence that linked him to specific government officials in direct command of the HRD. With the help of his friends still in the HRD, it was more than enough to clear John of all charges. DHS spearheaded an investigation to uncover the depths of corruption within the government. The aim was to identify and remove the people responsible for infiltrating the Hostile Response Division and any other branches and organizations compromised by the treasonous acts. John felt the investigation would be fruitless, with corrupt influence still holding sway over crucial positions of power conducting the investigation. It would be years before the cancer could be rooted out, and he no longer had the desire to work for the Hostile Response Division, or any organization similar. John stepped away and returned home to his previous life of peace. Great Falls, Montana. The sun rose through the clear blue sky, radiating its early afternoon heat. A late spring breeze blew defiantly against the arrival of the coming summer. John Stone wiped an arm across his forehead as he stood to admire the repairs he'd made to his porch railing. He found himself away from his home for much of the past year, but now that he was free, he spent his days fixing the place up. The hammer clanged into his toolbox as John dropped it before flipping the lid closed with his boot. He hoisted the tools up as he looked off in the distance. The sound of a car approaching reached him before he could actually see it. A dark sedan drove past the surrounding trees into the clearing and pulled up the long dirt road to his estate. It was no surprise to John, as he lived in a somewhat secluded area, and any car around here would be heading to his house. The car slowed to a stop on the driveway, tires crunching along the gravel, and the driver's side door swung open. A fit man with a light brown complexion stepped out. He kept his hair cut short, but was currently sporting the stubble of a beard that was only now starting to show a little gray. His easygoing expression was a contradiction to the authority he could exude with little effort. The man smiled, revealing a set of straight white teeth set into a square jaw.
"It's been a while, huh, John?" he said.
"Not long enough to have to see your ugly mug again," John said.
Marvin Van Pierce gave him a look of mock offense.
"Son, if you were half as good-looking as me, you would shave that mustache off so everyone could see your face."
After a moment of intense stares, both men erupted into laughter.
"Come on in. I've got some beers in the fridge," John said,
as he gestured to invite the man into his home. The interior of John's mountain cabin was sparsely decorated, yet comfortable. Though not minimalist, everything inside had its purpose and was sturdy in design. Its utilitarian nature reminded Van Pierce of the precision of a military barracks, but done with warm wood colors and plenty of natural light from the cabin's windows. John led Van Pierce to a small, round oak kitchen table. Marvin took a seat, and John pulled two bottles of beer from the fridge. He twisted the tops off and slid one across the table as he sat down. Marvin took a long swallow of the ice-cold drink and let out a sigh. The two men sat at the table like they were about to share stories of the good old days. But both of them knew that's not why the former HRD director would have driven all this way to visit.
"Any progress on the investigation?" John asked.
"You don't waste time, do you, John?" "Always a straight shooter," Van Pierce said.
John took a sip of his beer but said nothing.
"As a matter of fact, the investigation is still ongoing. The reports say they found one or two people involved in the lower-level government positions. They have yet to find any evidence implicating any officials at a higher level."
"Why am I not surprised?" John asked.
"Hey, there's nothing we can do about that right now. Let's be thankful that you were found not guilty of any wrongdoing, and just move on."
Marvin took another sip from his bottle.
"Besides, that's actually not why I'm here."
John raised an eyebrow, curious.
"I'm consulting," Van Pierce said. "I help other people catch bad guys now. Got a job working with a counter-terror task force in France."
John nodded, twirling a bottle cap between his fingers.
"Sounds lucrative."
"It pays the bills. If you want to come with me, I can make a call."
"No, I'm done,"
John interrupted. Marvin's expression didn't change. He knew John would refuse.
"Figured you wouldn't be interested. But I needed to toss the offer out there anyway. If you ever change your mind, you just say the word, and you're in," Van Pierce said.
John didn't speak, instead lifting his bottle and tilting his head in a thanks-for-the-offer gesture. He was really settling into this quiet, peaceful part of his life right now. They finished the rest of their beers, admiring the serene view out the window, and sharing some casual talk to catch up. John stood up as Marvin prepared to leave.
"It's been nice seeing you again, old man," John said with a grin.
Marvin laughed and clapped him on the shoulder. They shared a firm handshake between two tough old soldiers.
"Goodbye, John."
"Goodbye, Marvin."
John watched the man head out the door. He was not as tall as stone, but Van Pierce projected an authority that many were not capable of. John stood on the porch giving one last wave as the dark sedan pulled away and back down the dirt road. He contemplated the offer, tempted to feel that rush again, but the feeling left as fast as it came. The quiet life was all he wanted now. John finally turned and walked back into his house.
Chapter 2. Lyon, France.
3 days after his meeting with John Stone, Marvin Van Pierce was in France, coordinating with the elite tactical unit of the French National Police. Known as RAID, the Recherche, Assistance, Intervention, Dissuasion Unit was responsible for counterterrorism operations within the major cities of the country. With the recent deactivation of the Hostile Response Division and the reassignment of its active military members, Van Pierce became a highly recommended consultant by close contacts that he maintained with the United States government. His knowledge and experience battling terrorist groups and investigating acts of terrorism over the past 40 years made him an invaluable asset. On his current assignment, Van Pierce lent his knowledge and experience to the French government, coordinating with them to help locate and stop a new terrorist group that had splintered from ISIS. Though the group went active less than 1 year ago, they've already claimed responsibility for 3 public terrorist attacks throughout Europe, the last one occurring only a week ago. Now, Van Pierce sat in a small meeting room with Maurice Ouvraud, the General Secretary for Administration in the Ministry of the Armed Forces, Lionel Gavreau, the RAID Task Force leader, and a second-in-command, Christopher Brassard. A computer analyst and a language translator also sat in the room to help out when needed. Various photos plastered one wall of the room. Shots of French landmarks and government buildings covered part of it, while persons of interest filled another section. Passport pictures or other official ID photos and surveillance shots of unsuspecting suspects were tacked up and overlapping every available space. Whiteboards, covered in handwritten notes about the terrorist group and its members, sat on an adjacent wall. The sloppiness of the writing on the boards and his being rusty reading French made the information all but useless to Van Pierce. The raid task force leader stood at the front of the room and briefed everyone. He spoke mostly French, while the translator relayed the information to the American consultant. Though his reading was rusty, Marvin still had an ear for the language and was able to follow most of it without the help.
"The mission of this new group, known as the Four Serpents, is, for all purposes, the same as ISIS. But we believe they are attempting to escalate the levels of conflict," Gavreau said.
"What does that mean?" Avrard asked.
"Tracking all known and suspected members, we are finding evidence through captured emails and phone conversations that show an interest in increasing the size of their targets and the number of casualties."
"How many members have you found so far?" Van Pierce asked, also speaking in French.
"As far as confirmed members, our analysts have discovered these three," Gavreau said,
pointing to three photos lined up at the top of the photo wall.
"This is Basim El-Nazar. He was a known lower-ranking member of ISIS. His move to join the Serpents may have come with a promotion."
The photo was a surveillance shot, slightly blurry from being enlarged and zoomed.
"Abdul Ghani Al-Bashir is an engineer with a master's degree in chemistry. We strongly suspect he has built explosive devices used in past terrorist attacks, also for ISIS," Gavreau continued.
The translator continued to speak to Van Pierce as if he didn't understand French, but the American focused on the three photos while listening directly to the raid commander.
"Finally, this is Azar bin Hashim. He has declared himself the leader of the Four Serpents and has made no attempt to hide his intentions. The problem, however, is that we have almost no information about Bin Hashim's past. He has no known connection to any past terrorist activity or group."
Van Pierce narrowed his eyes at this information, and he studied the passport photo.
"Are you sure he's the leader and not just a puppet?" the American asked.
"Unlikely he's a puppet," the computer analyst blurted. "So far, we haven't traced any outgoing signals of any type from Bin Hashim that go to anyone other than the lower-ranking suspected members."
Van Pierce eyed the young analyst.
"Son, there are still effective ways to communicate that are older than cell phones and email."
"Again, unlikely. The amounts of coordination to pull off the attacks the Serpents have done in the past, and the ones they are possibly planning in the future, require exact precision and constant communication. We're confident that Azar bin Hashim is the head of the Serpent."
Van Pierce stared at the arrogant computer analyst until the man glanced down into the reports on the desk in front of him. Then Gavreau continued.
"Our analysts suspect Basim El-Nazar will meet with someone believed to have financed past terrorist attacks in Europe. We have no identification on this person except for his alias, Matthias Kepler, which we have learned with the aid of Mr. Van Pierce's U.S. contacts."
Everyone in the room was now studying the notes in front of them to learn what little they could about the mystery financier.
"There is a high probability that the meeting will be occurring in the Place des Terreaux in Lyon tomorrow. If we can spot El-Nazar and follow him to the meeting, we may be able to identify the financier," Gavreau said.
"It's a very public location. Many tourists," Overard said. "I can't stress the importance of not letting the situation get out of hand."
"Rest assured, sir. We plan to handle the entire operation covertly. Our operatives will be undercover and will not escalate the conflict unless absolutely necessary," Gavreau said.
Overard still looked a bit nervous, but nodded his approval.
"I guess that's a universal attitude for all government suits," Van Pierce thought.
The last few minutes of the meeting were spent giving a general plan the raid team would take before Gavreau dismissed everyone.
"It all goes down tomorrow, gentlemen. Let's all get some rest," Gavreau said.
Marvin Van Pierce rubbed his index finger along the bezel of his watch as he checked the time. 0900 hours. He sat in the passenger seat of a two-door silver Peugeot parked on the street, one block southwest from Place des Terreaux, between the Saône and Rhône rivers in Lyon. The crowds grew thicker as more people arrived in the square. Van Pierce was there that day as an extra set of eyes, and as a consultant to assist if the situation went sideways. It was made very clear to him by both Maurice Ouvrard and Lionel Gavreau
that he was not to have any physical involvement with today's operation. Being a foreigner and not an official member of any French police or military organization, they weren't interested in the possibility of an international incident. In the driver's seat, Simone Boudet, a RAID team member, was radioing updates. Van Pierce didn't have his own radio, so he listened to the responses coming in over Boudet's. Nearly a dozen RAID members positioned themselves in and around the Place de Terreau. They dressed in civilian clothing and blended in almost entirely. A few blocks away, in a nondescript panel truck, a RAID unit sat in full operational gear, prepared to move in if the situation spun out of control. 2 hours into the operation, radio chatter picked up. A couple of the undercover RAID members spotted Basim El-Nazar entering the southeast side of the square. Gavreau's voice came in over the channel, advising all teams to keep their eyes open. Radio communication from three different undercover operatives following covertly described the path El-Nazar took through the square. Responses from the other RAID members followed, giving their current position and status. This continued for the next few minutes as Marvin glanced up the street toward the Place de Terreau, even though he wasn't near the radioed positions. He scanned everyone, looking for postures or behaviors that might appear suspicious. It was a habit he gained from many years in the field, and was now second nature for him. It was because of this awareness that a face in the crowd triggered an alarm in his head. A man, with a jagged scar across his cheek, walked right past the silver Peugeot and into a crowd of tourists. Van Pierce snatched up his smartphone and scrolled through the photos from yesterday's briefing. His fingers froze on an image of a man with the same scar and intense eyes. It was Zain Alamon, someone the French government had suspected of being a member of the Four Serpents, but they couldn't verify. His appearance in this place at this time was just too much to be a coincidence. "That man there," Van Pierce said to his partner in the car, "that's Zain Alamon. We need someone on him now." Boudet nodded and radioed in the request. Van Pierce tried to keep a visual on his target as the radio responses came. "This is Unit 2. I can be there in 3 minutes." "That's not fast enough. He's going to disappear in that crowd," Van Pierce said, knowing how far they were positioned from the square. Without hesitation, he opened the door to follow Alamon. "Sir, you can't—" Boudet began before he was cut off. "Let the team know I'm tailing Alamon. Have them coordinate with me when they reach my location," Van Pierce said. Then he slipped into the crowd of people. Gavreau was positioned outside the Place de Terreau, in a discreet position that gave him a broad view of the area. He gritted his teeth at the call he just received from Boudet. Marvin Van Pierce was actively pursuing a man that may be on their list of suspected terrorist group members. Gavreau didn't want anyone but RAID personnel active in the area. Van Pierce was experienced, but the possible confusion and chaos of having a foreigner, a civilian at that, active in the operation, didn't sit well with the task force leader. Still, without the Americans' help, Gavreau's team may not have spotted the extra player. Van Pierce didn't have a radio with him, however, which made the situation even more frustrating. After a moment of thought, he thumbed his own radio.
"Unit 2, as soon as you get there, you relieve Mr. Van Pierce and have him stand down."
"Oui,"
the response came over the radio quickly. Gavreau set his focus back on observing the square while listening to the updates from the team following El-Nazar.
"Heading toward the cafe, on the east side of the fountain. This might be the meeting spot,"
one of the RAID members said.
"All right, stay on him and let us know if he leaves. All units, I want you to scan everyone in the area. Find anyone that might be there to meet him," Gavreau said.
After a minute of updates being radioed in, one transmission caught the task leader's attention.
"El-Nazar made contact with someone. They split up. The new target is moving southeast."
Gavreau prepared to coordinate his team to account for the new player when the radio channels lit up.
"He's got a bomb! El-Nazar!"
The radio transmission cut off a split second before Gavreau heard the explosions. Marvin Van Pierce worked his way through the crowd, tailing his target from a reasonable distance. He was a little rusty from years of not being out on the field, but found his skills were recalled pretty easily. Alamon crossed the street and entered the Place de Terreau from the southwest corner. He stayed on the outer edge, slowing and eventually stopping. He glanced around casually across the public square. A tremendous sculptured fountain, the Fontaine Bartholdi, dominated the center of the Place de Terreau. It featured a woman on a chariot, controlling four horses, each representing the four great rivers of France. Crowds gathered around the sculpture, sitting at the outdoor tables set up under canopies for the nearby restaurants. Lamont turned his gaze toward Marvin, but Van Pierce was sure to not make eye contact with his target, instead pretending to study the large fountain in the square. Next, Van Pierce swept his gaze across the area, looking for the other raid members. There were too many people around for him to make a positive ID on any of them, however. When he looked back, he saw Elamon reaching into the inner pocket of his jacket. Van Pierce moved closer, his focus like a laser on his target. Panicked voices suddenly screamed out from across the square. In the next instant, they were cut off by a deafening explosion. Van Pierce tore his eyes off Elamon and toward the blast. He felt the concussive force press against his chest, even this far away from the explosion, and saw smoke and dust rising in the northeast corner of the square, just past the fountain. Confusion and fear took the crowd. Then it turned to outright chaos and panic when the second blast went off. He saw the second explosion this time. It was a suicide bomber, also on the far side of the square in the southeast corner. While he turned his attention back to Elamon, Van Pierce whipped his hand to the back of his right hip, a pure reflex, and found the spot where he carried his pistol for so many years empty. He saw his target holding a small device now, staring into the crowd of people. The two explosions caused a panic as terror washed over everyone, like the fire and heat from the blasts themselves. They ran away from the death and destruction and out of the square. Sudden horror dawned on Van Pierce. The two explosions had occurred on the other end of the public square, detonated in a position that would force the panicked bystanders to move in this direction. Lambs led to the slaughter, right into the position of Alamon, the third bomber. Van Pierce cursed himself for being too late to catch the attacks, but he sprang into action, knowing he had to do something right now. He bolted for Alamon, shoving people away and shouting a warning to the bystanders. He shot in low and buried his shoulder into Alamon's midsection. The momentum of his body carried the man off his feet. Van Pierce wouldn't be able to stop this blast, but he would try to minimize the damage it could cause. He plowed the man into the street, between a panel truck and a van that stopped after the first explosion. The two men landed partially under the delivery truck when the explosives engulfed Elamon and Van Pierce in fire and fury.
Chapter 3.
At approximately 11 a.m. local time, 9 a.m. Greenwich Mean Time, three men detonated explosive devices strapped to their bodies in the Place de Tarot located in Lyon, France. John stared at his television in silence, watching the news report about the terrorist attack in France. The damage in the public square is extensive. 10 people have been confirmed dead at this time, and at least 50 people have been injured by the blasts. Once again, the four Serpents have claimed responsibility for this horrific terrorist attack. In a video statement released, a sense of dread formed in the pit of his stomach. John stood and walked to the phone, each step only serving to intensify his fears. He had to call to make sure Marvin Van Pierce was okay. The phone rang right as he grabbed hold of it. John closed his eyes and brought the receiver up to his ear.
Hello?
John, it's Parker.
Hearing Parker Lewis's voice confirmed his worst fears. Before joining the Hostile Response Division, John had saved Parker's life. He was a brilliant, if eccentric, computer specialist for the HRD.
Parker, I need to call Van Pierce. He may be hurt, John said.
John, I'm sorry. Van Pierce is dead, Parker said.
John's fist tightened over the phone receiver, nearly crushing it in his grip. Deep down, he knew it was the truth. Parker wouldn't be calling John to get more information. If he was calling, that meant he already knew the situation.
Are you sure?
John asked, holding out hope that his gut was wrong.
Yes. Marvin told me about his assignment after he spoke with you. The moment I heard the news about the attack, I scoured around for everything I could about it. Officers on the scene confirmed his identity 10 minutes ago. It hasn't gone public yet.
Numbness set in as John's vision swam. He clutched the phone tighter and sat at the chair next to the small table.
Are you all right, John?
Parker asked. John sat in silence for what felt like hours before finally answering.
I should have gone with him. If I was there, maybe...
There's nothing you could have done.
It was a coordinated attack that no one was prepared for. If you were there with Marvin, you might be dead too.
John knew Parker was right, but had a hard time accepting it. Parker's words hit John deeply, but at that moment he had made a decision.
I'm going to France. I need to know what happened, John said, resigned.
John, what do you think you can accomplish there? We aren't with the HRD anymore. Just stay there and I'll find out what I can, Parker said. Please.
John's neck and jaw tightened.
I'm leaving tonight.
Then let me come with you. I can help, Parker started.
No, it's dangerous. I don't want you to risk your life over this, John said.
But it's okay if you do, Parker asked.
This isn't your responsibility. I could have helped Van Pierce. But now I need answers. I owe him that much.
Parker let out a sigh on the other end.
All right, John. Please be careful. Let me know if there's anything I can do to help. I owe him too.
Chapter 4
Shoulders brushing the walls of the narrow alleyway, a burly man strode through the back entrance of a small printing shop. The whirring and clattering of machines replaced the bustle of activity from outside. The man widened his eyes, waiting for them to adjust to the darkness before proceeding. He stepped into a back room, shuffled to one corner, and greeted three men sitting around a table. The man facing him, Azar bin Hashim, nodded as he took another drag from his cigarette.
Praise be to Allah, the man said with his head bowed.
What do you have for me?
Bin Hashim asked as smoke puffed out between syllables. The man produced a small tablet computer. He tapped the screen a few times and handed the device over to the leader. Bin Hashim examined the information, the blue LED glow lighting his face from underneath, casting his features with a more sinister appearance. Satisfied, he nodded and placed the device casually on the center of the table.
Is this information accurate? He asked.
Yes. We have confirmation that the German survived, the man said.
Bin Hashim thought over the information for a minute, taking another drag from his cigarette. He blew out a stream of smoke.
Send someone to Hôpital de la Quarry. Find the German and finish what we started, Bin Hashim said. The next phase of our plan is too important. We must tie up all loose ends.
The man nodded to the leader of the four serpents and walked out, exiting through the back door where he entered.
What should we do now?
One of the other men at the table asked.
Proceed as planned. The doctor will be in town soon. Have the men ready to move when they hear from me,
Bin Hashim said, stabbing the butt of the cigarette into the ashtray. The men nodded and stood. Bin Hashim could see they all knew what was expected of them, working toward the same goal. He clutched the medallion around his neck, four snakes entwined around the world, before tucking it into his shirt. The four serpents would strike fear into the hearts of the West. They would crush the spirit of the enemy. The world would not be able to deny them any longer. Chapter 5 Lyon, France. Grabbing his bag and looping the strap over his shoulder, John draped his light jacket over one arm as he stepped out of the cab. He had difficulty sleeping on the long flight, thinking about Van Pierce and the terrorist attack from the previous day. His head hurt, and his joints creaked and protested as he stretched on the sidewalk. Knowing the police would have the area restricted, John had to walk the several remaining blocks to the Place de Tourneau. While the city was far from busy, the amount of activity near the attack surprised John. He got a feel for the block and the people as he approached his destination. The pain and fear evident in their actions, the people carried out their day-to-day activities nonetheless. An act of defiance showing the terrorists that they were still strong and unafraid after the attack. John brought only a laptop and a change of clothes, on top of the few travel necessities with him, opting to travel light. Everything he needed was with him in the bag around his shoulder, except for a weapon. He knew traveling abroad meant going in unarmed, but he didn't expect a second attack in the same location so soon. Much of the initial investigation had already happened the day before, but the police still had the entire block taped off. Investigators buzzed around, gathering evidence at the blast sites and taking pictures of everything that appeared out of place,
Several officers diverted traffic to different routes, creating more confusion and congestion. The honking and understandable frustration gave John enough cover to get closer. He walked the perimeter of the Place de Tourneau, looking over the area and paying particular attention to the three locations where the terrorists detonated their bombs. During the flight, he pored over all of the information Parker sent him, including news stories providing an already out-of-date account of the events of the attack. He crossed the police barrier to look at the spot where the third device went off, studying the two vehicles damaged in the explosion. The blast pattern revealed that the device exploded under the back end of the more massive truck. The detonation shredded the tires and left the rear bumper in shambles. The entire back end of the vehicle crumpled upward. Bits of broken glass littered the street and sidewalk, from the shattered windows of both trucks and the nearby shops.
"This is where Marvin Van Pierce died."
John took a moment to reflect on the man. They had known each other only for a short time, but Van Pierce still risked his life and career to save him and clear his name when John faced treason charges. Tightening his fists, John vowed that he would find the ones responsible for Marvin Van Pierce's death. According to Parker's reports, Van Pierce's final act of sacrifice had saved many more lives. Tackling the suicide bomber under the truck contained a considerable portion of the damage, significantly reducing the number of casualties the third blast caused to the frightened people fleeing the first two explosions.
"A hero to the end," John said quietly, looking to the clear blue sky.
"Que fait aussi?"
a voice snapped John out of his thoughts. He turned to see a stern man in black fatigues and gloves. He wore a tactical vest with a name tag that read Gavreau. John hadn't spoken French in many years, and he was caught off guard for a moment.
"I'm sorry, I don't speak..."
"What are you doing here?"
Gavreau interrupted, speaking heavily accented English now.
"This is no place for tourists right now."
"Just looking around. My friend was here yesterday,"
John said.
Gavreau furrowed his brow. "This is still an active crime scene. You cannot be here right now."
"His name was Marvin Van Pierce. He was here working as a consultant with you,"
John said. The man's face softened and his tone changed to match.
"I am sorry, sir, but you cannot be here. This area is not open to the public right now."
"You must go," Gavreau said.
The two stood to face each other for a few tense seconds. Gavreau was every inch as tall as John, though his build was leaner than the ranger's muscular bulk. Another man in the same military-style uniform walked at a brisk pace toward Gavreau. His name tag read Brassard. They spoke in French using lowered voices, so John couldn't hear, much less understand what was being said.
"Let me help," John said. "I worked with Van Pierce, and I have experience dealing with terrorists."
Gavreau looked up from his conversation.
"No, we do not need your help. This is official police business."
"All right. If it's okay with you, I'd like to look around just a little more. I won't step on any toes."
"We cannot have civilians in our crime scene," Gavreau said. "We do not want to deal with the international problems if an American tourist got hurt nosing around. Stay out of this, or I will have you arrested."
Brassard spoke to John.
"I apologize, sir, but the situation is delicate. We must ask you to move beyond the barrier around this square, please."
His English had almost no accent, and his tone was calmer. John nodded to Brassard and Gavreau, then turned and left the Place de Tourneau. He had no intention of staying out of this, but for now, he would have to operate from the shadows to avoid arrest. He shouldered his bag and pulled out his phone to arrange for a cab to take him to a hotel. From there, he would be able to dig deeper into Parker's research, using what he saw on site to put more of the pieces together, and gain a better understanding of the events that had transpired.
Chapter 6.
John sat at the small desk in his hotel room. He opted for the most basic of comforts, a single bed, bathroom, and mini-office. By all accounts, this room would be considered more cozy than utilitarian, but it served all his needs for now. The laptop beeped and whirred as it came to life, ready to work. John wanted to reread the data Parker sent before he left, but enough time had passed that footage from other people in the area started popping up online. He watched every available video, sometimes bringing two different videos side by side in order to build a mental picture of the attack. Parker wasn't able to secure any of the footage from the CCTV cameras mounted around the scene, so he had to watch only what was publicly available, uploaded to various social media and video sharing sites. All of the footage had been taken by mobile phones or handheld cameras. In the chaos and confusion, it was difficult for John to make heads or tails of the necessary details he needed. Without any type of image stabilization, discerning directions or even number of attackers was next to impossible. Rubbing his temples and then his eyes with his fingertips, John felt every second of the 2 hours he had just spent watching and re-watching the videos that he thought held the most promise. Still, it was a futile venture.
"This is going to be impossible without the footage from the city's cameras."
The old wooden chair creaked as John leaned back, folding his arms across his chest. He took in a deep breath to calm his mind.
"Perhaps a few hours of sleep would do me some good," he thought. "Maybe by then Parker will be able to..."
A new notification popped up in his search. The latest video from the terrorist attack sat at the top of his queue, and the quality of the thumbnail image gave him a small boost of energy. John watched the video, taken near the first explosion, in the northwest corner of the Place de Tourneau. The clarity of the footage gave him hope, but so far it was all just information he had been able to piece together in his initial research. A crowd of people dined near the Fontaine Bertholdi when a man stood up and detonated an explosive device on his person. John sighed, ready to close the video, when he stopped himself, finger hovering over the touchpad. Something caught his attention at a subconscious level, but he didn't know why. He viewed the footage again, scrubbing the timeline back and forth, studying the screen for any details he may have missed. It was the moment before the blast when he noticed the man seated at a table next to the bomber. The terrorist and the mystery man sat back to back at different tables, but the mystery man was already moving away from him before the detonation. The timing of his movement felt out of place to John. His actions didn't fit the sequence of events. The man rose from his table and moved away much earlier than anyone else in the crowd, before the bomber even physically revealed any evidence of his explosive. Something spooked him. When the terrorist stood, he turned and directed his attention to the mystery man.
"Who are you?" John said, staring at the paused frame.
The footage was too blurry to make a positive identification, so John checked through all of the videos he felt provided the best information during his initial viewing. He singled out all of the footage that pointed in the direction of the Fontaine Bertholdi before, during, and after the attack. On the third video, he hit pay dirt. A tourist, standing on the opposite side, filmed the statue as the first explosive detonated. John saw the mystery man running from the bomber toward the camera. The footage shook and dropped from the explosion, then panned back to the site of the blast. The mystery man emerged from inside the fountain, soaking wet. He somehow managed to leap into the water to escape the brunt of the explosion. The tourist continued filming as he backed away. The crowd ran past him, parting long enough for John to get a better angle on the man's features. John rewound the video and paused it. His jaw tightened. The mystery man was long suspected of financing terrorist activities. Even during John's years serving as an Army Ranger, they sought this man in the War on Terror. He was known under different aliases, but the one John was most familiar with was Dietrich Werner. If this is the man John suspected he was, why were they trying to kill him in the terrorist attack? Did he manage to survive the second and third blasts as well? It was possible, which meant Werner could still be out there. John pulled up a list of all of the videos showing the second and third explosions, carefully attempting to track Werner's movements during and after the attack. He found a far camera shot of the third explosion, shot from outside the Place de Tourneau on a connecting street. He spotted the man moving away from the first two explosions in the general direction of the third. John's heart sank when he saw the blurred movements of a figure that moved to tackle another man. Marvin Van Pierce, putting himself in harm's way to try and stop the third bomber. Marvin sacrificed himself to save as many as he could. he had been able to take the man down near two parked vehicles, which absorbed much of the explosive force when the bomb detonated. At the moment of the blast, John caught an image of Dietrich falling. It was only a couple of frames, but he was close to the final explosion, and Pierce's actions may have reduced the force enough for the man to survive. If he were still alive, he would need medical attention, given his proximity to the first and third bombs. John dug through the files Parker sent him to read on the flight over. He needed more information about Dietrich Warner. Why would the four serpents be targeting him? Was his presence a coincidence? A single reference came up, a list of known aliases for a person of interest. Dietrich was one of many aliases used by Matthias Kepler, the man Marvin Van Pierce highlighted in the briefing notes that Parker had been able to retrieve.
"Mr. Kepler," John said, resting his elbows on the desk as he stared at the image in the video. "Perhaps we'll finally be able to meet face to face, so you can answer some questions."
The latest news reports about the attack mentioned that first responders had transported the injured people to Hôpital de la Croix-Rouge. He closed the screen of his laptop and headed out the door to find his next lead. The hallways of Hôpital de la Croix-Rouge swarmed with activity. Doctors and nurses sped around the concerned friends and family members of the injured tourists and citizens. Kalik, a member of the Four Serpents, had no trouble slipping into the supply area to get a set of scrubs to wear in the ensuing confusion. He came here with explicit orders to find Matthias Kepler. Dressing as hospital staff was risky, but dealing with the seemingly non-stop flow of victims helped him slip through unquestioned. Several times someone barked orders at him to go somewhere and assist or bring something that one of the doctors needed. Each time he answered with an enthusiastic nod before disappearing. Matthias Kepler secretly funded Azar bin Hashim and the Four Serpents through his many shell companies for their next ambitious plan. Bin Hashim didn't trust a man of Kepler's questionable loyalties and planned for his death in the attack on Place de Tourraume. Kalik stepped behind an unattended reception desk and sat in front of the computer. His fingers pecked across keys, searching for Kepler's room, as the switches of the old keyboard clicked loudly. His brows furrowed when the name came up with no results. His target, it seems, was also the type of man to cover his tracks. Matthias Kepler was probably the type of man with a list of aliases to use in his day-to-day life. Paranoid. After a moment of thought, Kalik's hands moved over the keys again. He brought up a list of the patients admitted into the hospital shortly after yesterday's attack. He scanned through the results, memorizing the rooms where the most recent patients had been admitted. Kalik stood and stepped back into the hallway, passing someone as he exited. The woman gave him a quizzical look as she sat, but soon slipped back into the task at hand, dealing with another influx of patients. He glanced down at the chart for the man and woman admitted to the first room. The victims in the beds had been badly burnt, their bodies bandaged, and they were heavily medicated. Not finding his mark, he turned and left, sidestepping a nurse coming in to check on their vital stats. Finding his target would require that he search the rooms one by one. This would not be a problem for him. He was a patient man that operated with precision. It would not be long before he cleaned up the loose end, Kepler, before he could reveal anything he might know about the serpents or their next plan.
Chapter 7.
John walked into the hospital and looked across the lobby. He wasn't sure how he would find Dietrich Warner in here, but this was his best shot. John stopped the nearest staff member.
"Excuse me," he said to the young woman, dressed in scrubs. "I'm wondering if you can help me find someone."
The woman stared back with weary eyes, replying in French. John winced, not able to understand anything she said. He continued in English, speaking slower and hoping the woman would understand enough to help him out.
"My brother was hurt yesterday,"
John started, miming an explosion with his hands. The woman seemed to catch on to what he was saying, so he continued.
"He's supposed to be here. Where can I find him?"
They struggled to communicate, as her English was as bad as his French. But eventually, she directed him to the wing of the hospital, triaging everyone involved in yesterday's terrorist attack. John thanked the woman in English, and then again in passable French.
She smiled and excused herself to continue her work. John sighed as he looked down the crowded hall. This would be a little more complicated than expected. John didn't let the difficulty dissuade him. As an Army Ranger, he was always prepared for things to be more challenging than initially planned. He walked down the hallway, heading for the section of the hospital the woman described. His initial urge was to ask any and everybody where he would go to find his brother injured in the attack, but John wanted to stay under the radar. The last thing he wanted was to draw any unnecessary attention to himself right now. He made his way through the hospital until the people in and around him looked like they were all there for the same reason, suffering from similar burns, cuts, and bruises typical of injuries inflicted by an explosion. Distraught friends and family packed the waiting areas, in need of treatment, or hoping for any good news from the doctors and nurses. He saw people agitated at the lack of information or attention they were receiving. Anger, fear, frustration. John made his way to a receptionist's desk and tried again to find his brother. He made an attempt at foregoing English and speaking French, ultimately having to resort to a mix of the two languages to get his message across. Luck was on his side this time, as the man replied in English.
I am sorry to hear about your brother.
What is his name?
Warner, Dietrich Warner, John said.
The man typed a few keystrokes, then stared at the screen for a minute. He leaned in close before sitting back and typing something else. His brows furrowed.
I don't see a Werner, but there is a Dietrich Bern. Similar name, but...
That's him,
John interrupted, with a relieved smile.
I forgot he's using Bern for his businesses. I'm sorry, my mind is a little frazzled after...
He waved his hand briefly in the air, resisting the urge to over-explain the situation, knowing it would only cause more suspicion and confusion.
Okay. Dietrich is in room 513. It is on the fifth floor.
Thank you. I can find it,
John interrupted again as he turned to go. Before the man could suspect any foul play, an irate husband demanded to speak to a doctor to find out what was happening with his wife, giving John the cover he needed to slip away. Kalik spent the past hour in the hospital, moving room to room. He glanced into each doorway, trying to find the man he was sent to kill. The German financier was too involved in the Serpent's actions. He knew too much, and Bin Hashim's plans were too important to allow anyone to put them at risk. Anyone else in Kalik's shoes would succumb to the frustration and fatigue with such a repetitive task. He was a special breed, however. The thrill of this hunt fueled him. His whole life, he was always precise and technical in everything he did. He rarely suffered the type of mental fatigue that others would experience after long hours of repetitious tasks. He continued the door-to-door hunt, searching for his target, and continually moving with the same mannerisms of the hospital staff around him. That was another skill he learned when he was a young boy. Kalik always had a knack for picking out and remembering subtle physical details and mannerisms of people, allowing him to mimic his friends and family. Now on the fifth floor of the hospital, Kalik resumed his mission. At the fourth door he checked, he saw a man in one of the beds with a build similar to Kepler. The chart listed the man as Dietrich Bern. The Serpent slipped into the room, making sure no one else was in there to disturb the two of them. Once he approached, Kalik saw that this was indeed Matthias Kepler, admitted under an alias. He walked to the side of the bed and stared into the face of the man as he slept. Dietrich groaned and opened his eyes slowly, turning his head to look over at Kalik. Kepler mistook him as a nurse at first glance as he struggled to keep his eyes open. The assassin continued to stare down at the person in the bed, patiently waiting for recognition to set in. He wanted Dietrich, Kepler, to know his end was coming. Realization struck as the man's eyes flew open wide. Because of the internal damage he suffered in the final explosion, the doctors had hooked Kepler up to a respirator. Unable to scream for help, he clawed at the side of his bed, searching for the button to call the nurses for assistance. Kalik looked on in amusement for another few seconds, with a sadistic grin, and held the button up by its cord in his hand. He shook his head and made a tisk-tisk sound. He placed the switch on a side table, out of reach, and descended on Matthias Kepler. Lionel Gavreau strode down the corridor of the fifth floor of the Hôpital de la Croix Rouge. He stopped and leaned against a wall, swiping up on his phone through the endless barrage of messages and emails.
The bureaucrats, overseeing a raid and its investigation into the terrorist attack, bombarded him with nonstop requests and demands for more information. None of that mattered to him at this moment. He was here for his teammates now. Several members of his raid team suffered injuries in the blasts at the Place de Taureau yesterday. Two were currently in critical condition. Gavreau had been in the hospital for the past hour, waiting for any updates on his injured teammates. He dropped the phone into a jacket pocket and rocked his head side to side, cracking his neck with each movement. It did little to hold the fatigue at bay. Gavreau stepped into the room of a man with minor injuries from the attack. His man had a concussion, and the doctors wanted him kept under observation. He had his bed upright and was surfing through the television stations, looking for something to watch other than coverage of the terrorist attack.
"You don't have to stay here, sir," Alban Lussier said to his commander. "Don't worry. I'm not concerned about you. I'm just in here so no one bothers me, while I wait to hear about the teammates I actually like," Gavreau said.
Lussier laughed and thumbed the TV remote, finally settling on a rerun of Friends, dubbed in French.
"I'm going to get a coffee. Want anything?" Gavreau asked on his way out.
"A cigarette," the man answered.
The raid commander shook his head and stepped into the hallway. With the chaos of yesterday's attack settling down, the crowds had thinned, but the hospital was still buzzing with plenty of activity. Gavreau headed down the hall toward a vending machine when a man leaving one of the rooms caught his eye. He was a large, muscular man in jeans and a thin, long-sleeved shirt. There was no mistaking the heavy mustache visible from the man's profile. It was the American wandering the crime scene this morning. The activity around the room the American had just left suddenly picked up. That was when Gavreau noticed the constant beep of flatlining patient whistling to the door. Nurses fluttered into the room, followed by a doctor, treating the patient in his bed. Everyone nearby showed an expected level of curiosity and concern in a situation like this, except for the American. The big man moved away, quickly down the hall, as close to a near run as he could manage without alerting anyone around him. Gavreau had no such concerns as he charged down the hallway after the suspicious tourist. It was no coincidence that he would be crossing paths with the man twice, both times related to the terrorist attack. He pushed people out of his way as he moved down the corridor. The American was not difficult to track, as he was much larger than most of the people around him. But even with fewer people wandering around, Gavreau had difficulty moving through the crowd efficiently. The raid leader increased his pace and began shouting at the people near him to get clear, when he saw his target slip around a corner out of sight. Gavreau was losing patience and shoved people forcefully out of his way as he struggled to catch the suspect. The aggressive actions only served to agitate the already stressed people in the hospital around Gavreau.
"Just great," Gavreau thought.
The additional anger and confusion were only going to make his job that much harder. John exited the elevator on the fifth floor and turned toward Dietrich Byrne's room. He looked around and saw raid members in the hallways. John kept his head down and walked briskly past them. They were most likely here to see to the members of their team injured, so he didn't want to aggravate them any more. The room he was looking for was not far, but there were a lot of police officers around, so it would be difficult to get in and out of unless he was utterly discreet about it. He found door 513 and scouted it patiently. After several minutes, no medical staff had entered or exited. John moved toward the room. He didn't expect to see any doctors or nurses inside, so it caught John off guard when he saw the man in medical scrubs stepping out, just as he was about to step in. He paused for a moment, looking away to avoid attracting the attention of the man. When he was in the clear once more, John stepped into the room. Stepping just inside, he stopped, processing what he saw. Matthias lay still in his bed, eyes open. At first, John thought the man was focused on the TV and not paying attention to him entering the room. Only, the TV wasn't on. In the hall, over the crowds talking and the noise from the increased activity in the hospital at that moment, John didn't hear the heart rate monitor. Once he stepped into the room, the sustained beep was loud and clear, a siren going off to alert everyone in the hospital. John cursed. He needed to leave now. The noise in the hall quieted down once the people nearby finally heard the beeping. Someone called for a doctor. John turned to leave, but hesitated. He saw the clothes of the dead man in a chair next to the bed. Hoping for something that could keep his investigation going, he snatched the man's wallet. Perhaps it might lead John to the next clue. Half expecting the man in the scrubs to come back into the room, John started in the opposite direction as he exited. When he stepped out, nurses and doctors filed past to get into the room. He caught a glimpse of the man in scrubs leaving the scene. John paused for a beat, watching him. He was the only medical staff near the room to not turn back and help. Suspicion overtook John, and he followed the man. He moved quickly, without going into a full run, to avoid suspicion. He tried to gain on the man in the scrubs, catching only brief glimpses of his curly hair cut close along the sides. The man was smaller, able to slip past the crowds in the hall with little difficulty. His uncanny ability to read the movement of the people around him and avoid a collision was a stark contrast to John's broad frame nearly knocking the people in the crowd down as he walked through. John continued to push past as delicately as he could, but he was losing the man in the scrubs. Once he rounded the next corner, John increased his speed. He knocked down one of the patients accidentally, who let out an angry cry, and almost stopped to help the person. Unfortunately, the sound of the patient yelling caught the attention of the target John was pursuing. The man in the scrubs turned and looked John right in the eye. He looked impassive, unsurprised even when he found out he was being followed. The man simply turned and started to run through the hallway, now finding the crowds thinning out. John began to pick up his own pace when he heard someone yelling behind him. "Stop!" the voice said. John didn't slow down, instead turning his head to see who was shouting. The raid agent from earlier today, Gavreau, was moving toward him. He must have seen John leave room 513 and suspected him of killing Matthias. John had to keep going, or he would lose the real person responsible for Dietrich Werner's death. He shouldered his way into the empty parts of the hall and broke into a full run. The man in the scrubs turned down another hall, trying to lose his tail. John followed around the corner and didn't see the man. He glanced around, scanning for anything that stood out. A door just clicked shut a moment after he turned the corner. John stepped through that same door, stepping into a series of connected examination rooms with a small corridor running between them, with an exit door located at the far end of the hall. John resisted the urge to plow ahead to the door on the far end, and possibly allowing the man to slip behind him to double back. He did a quick visual search of each room on his way to the far exit. Halfway down the corridor, John pushed the curtain open to inspect the next room. A figure burst out, catching him off guard. A kick thrust into the center of John's chest with enough force to steal his breath and knock him back several steps. The man landed and continued a rapid-fire assault on the much larger American. Compared to John, he lacked the size and strength for a straight-up fight, but his speed and technique made him formidable. John used his muscular forearms to deflect and absorb the incoming attacks, and he cursed to himself, as he could only stop two out of every three strikes. John fired back his own punches, his heavy fists finding only air. A front kick shot through John's defenses, driving into his stomach. The speed and power of the attack pushed him back on his heels into a cart filled with supplies. The man in scrubs took the opportunity to make a break for the far corridor exit. John reached behind him and hurled the entire supply cart at the fleeing man. It crashed into his back, sending him sprawling with a yelp. John lunged forward and brought a stomp down on his target. The man barely rolled away as a heavy boot cracked the tile flooring. In one smooth turn, the man on the floor whipped a roundhouse kick across John's jaw and spun to his feet. John reached for him, dazed, but he rolled up and over across John's back. The man hit the floor and dashed toward the original door they entered through. John shook the cobwebs from his head and spun to pursue. John crashed out through the door, heading back into the hospital to find his target, but caught the attention of Gavreau. The raid commander followed the sound of the commotion and arrived to see the American emerge into the hallway.
"Stop right now,"
Gavreau yelled in heavily accented English. John was in an awkward spot now. He needed to find the man responsible for killing Kepler, but running away from Gavreau would do nothing to prove his own innocence. Not having time to explain, John turned and bolted down the hall, away from Gavreau. The raid man cursed and gave chase. Despite John's size, he was a surprisingly fast runner, and his conditioning was more than up to the task of carrying his heavy frame at a run. Gavreau was leaner and quicker, however, closing the distance. John had to guess where the man in scrubs could have gone while keeping away from Gavreau. He sprinted toward the nearest stairwell, figuring the man was attempting to leave the building. Gavreau was closing fast, and before John could get through the stairwell door, the raid commander was on top of him. Gavreau collided with John, and they both spilled into the stairwell. The momentum of the two large men carried them down the steps to the landing halfway down one flight. Gavreau rolled, trying to gain the top position. John shot a muscular arm out and pulled the Frenchman to the ground while he got up to one knee.
"I'm sorry about this," John said, before his fist cracked across Gavreau's jaw.
The commander went limp, and John tried to lay him down as gently as he could before resuming his chase. He continued down the stairs and into the first-floor lobby. John looked around everywhere, trying to find any clues about where to find the man. Nothing. He went outside and scanned in every direction. His quarry had vanished. He ground his jaw tight, furious at losing both his target and the fight against him. John had to flee the area. He would most likely be a murder suspect, and fighting with Gavreau would definitely not help the situation. Once he was far enough from the hospital, John stepped into an alley and rifled through the wallet, finding an ID for Dietrich Byrne. He had no guarantee that the address listed wasn't fake, but John didn't have any other options at this point. He considered going back to his hotel room to check out in case the police were looking for him. There was little doubt the raid man he knocked out would discover his identity and begin searching for him. If he didn't follow his one lead, however, he might lose his only chance to stop the four serpents before they strike again.
Chapter 8
Gavreau rubbed his jaw with one hand. Clenching his teeth harder only served to intensify the pain, but his anger won out as he breathed deeply, in and out through flared nostrils. The American had gotten away, but not before assaulting the raid commander.
"For that you will pay dearly."
In the security room of the hospital, Gavreau reviewed the video footage covering the fifth floor, specifically the camera that provided a view of 513, the room where the victim, Dietrich Byrne, had been murdered. He watched the American exit into the hall as nurses and doctors flooded in past him.
"Run the feed back a few minutes," Gavreau said through still clenched teeth.
The security tech nodded and complied.
"There, stop,"
Gavreau pointed at the screen. They watched for a minute until he saw what caught his attention while the tech rewound the footage. A man wearing hospital scrubs entered the room.
"Who is that?" Gavreau asked.
The hospital administrator leaned closer to examine the feed.
"I don't know this man. I'll get the records of everyone on the floor and find out."
"You may not find him," Gavreau thought.
The man looked like a staff member of the hospital, but something about him triggered an alarm in Gavreau's head. No one else entered or exited the room for a couple of minutes until the American entered the frame for the first time. Gavreau's jaw ached and tightened when he saw him. He watched the man walk past the raid members in the hall, his head low, heading straight for room 513. The man in scrubs exited, walking right past the American. Gavreau focused on the man in the hospital scrubs this time. He noted the man continued to walk away, not reacting to the frantic nurses running by him, or the flatlining beep Gavreau remembered hearing at that moment.
"Perhaps it was you," he said, his voice low.
The American, after exiting the room, spotted the man in the scrubs and moved straight in his direction. Shortly after, the footage showed Gavreau running to catch up to them. Christopher Brassard entered the security room with a few sheets of paper in his hand.
"Sir, here is the information you requested," he said, handing them over.
Gavreau took the papers and looked over the information about the identity of the American.
"John Stone, a lieutenant, serving in the United States Army for 20 years. Most of that time he served as an Army Ranger, recipient of the Distinguished Service Cross," Brassard said, as Gavreau read the report. He continued to scan the pages. After he retired from the Army, Stone worked at a bar in Great Falls, Montana, of which he was also a part owner. Gavreau saw the news stories Brassard printed about the kidnapping of a girl, Emily Colt. He read about John Stone's involvement, rescuing her from her kidnappers. Shortly after that, Stone officially joined a joint military task force called the Hostile Response Division. Gavreau skimmed a brief history of the HRD and its director, Marvin Van Pierce. "Sir, I don't think he was the one responsible for killing Dietrich Byrne, the man in 513, Brassard said.
Gavreau grunted. He figured that was the case, and the video footage, with this report, confirmed it for him.
"Don't expect me to cheer for this John Stone, Chris," Gavreau said, absently touching his jaw again.
"What next?" Brassard asked.
"Find out more about Dietrich in room 513. Why was he targeted?" Gavreau said.
Brassard held out another sheet of paper.
"Right here, sir."
Gavreau took the page with a surprised look on his face and nodded.
Dietrich Bern, a German businessman, currently living in...
Bassard started.
Gavreau shot a glare at his second-in-command.
Why do you hand me these papers if you're just going to read them to me? Gavreau asked.
Sorry,
Bassard said with a smile.
My job is to provide you with information.
Well, our next move is to find out everything we can about Dietrich Bern. Chris, get the authorization we need to search his residence and meet me outside.
Yes, sir.
Gavreau headed toward the elevator, rereading the report about John Stone, working his jaw side to side to make sure it wasn't fractured.
That man hits harder than a truck.
Somewhere near Lyon, France. At Matthias Kepler's address, John walked the block once more. He scouted for any sign of police or terrorists, satisfied that the streets were clear. He carried a brown paper bag with groceries from a nearby market to help him appear as if he belonged in the neighborhood. The delicious aroma from the still warm baguette protruding from the bag reminded John that he hadn't eaten anything for quite a while now. Leafy green swayed gently with each step as John walked casually to the front entrance of the apartment building. He pretended to check his phone, waiting for a moment to time his entry. A woman exited, and John started walking, still pretending to stare at the screen on his phone as he approached. The woman offered to hold the door open to let him in. He smiled and nodded as he passed the woman, not wanting to risk anything in French. He made his way to the stairs and started up to Kepler's floor. Taking the steps two at a time, John reached his destination quickly. At the door to the apartment, he put down the brown bag, finishing a mouthful of the baguette. He tested the doorknob, not surprised in the least, to find it locked. Glancing up and down the hall, John checked to make sure no one else was around. Satisfied to see he was alone, he grasped the handle tightly and drove his shoulder into the door. Wood creaked and gave way with little protest to John's mass and strength, swinging open to reveal a dimly lit living room. Light shone through the closed blinds and stripes, like an old detective noir film. John slipped into the apartment, picking up the grocery bag and swinging the door closed as far as it would go. He searched through the rooms quickly, looking for any clues that would link Kepler to the four serpents. He powered up the computer on a small desk in one corner. While he waited, John rifled through the tidy stack of mail on the kitchen table, a few junk mail letters and a couple of bills, but not much else. He opened up the drawers, rummaging around for anything that would point him in the right direction. After the cursory search turned up nothing useful, the computer's pleasant chime and the whirring fans got John's attention as the monitor flickered to life. John clicked the mouse and found a prompt screen asking for a password to log in. He cursed to himself for not letting Parker come with him to France. This obstacle would likely prove little challenge for the gifted programmer. He thought about calling and having Parker talk him through bypassing the screen, but decided it would take more time than he probably had. John decided to dig a little deeper through all of the drawers in the apartment. Kepler kept his place neat and tidy. This was both good and bad for John, as it meant while it wouldn't take long to go through the available notes and other information, there just wouldn't be much for him to actually search through. After the desk drawers proved fruitless, John headed into the bedroom. He tossed the contents of the two nightstand drawers onto the bed, but stopped while he held the second empty drawer in his hand. This one felt lighter than the first after he had dumped everything out. It was only a slight difference, but enough for John to notice. He put the drawer down and grabbed the first one. His hunch was correct. This one felt heavier. He turned it over in his hands and noticed that it was the slightest bit shallower inside as well. With no time for subtlety, John smashed his fist through the bottom of the drawer. The thin, false underside splintered, revealing a leather-bound black notebook wedged inside. John plucked the journal from the drawer and saw a small flash drive tucked next to it. Mouth drawn in a straight line, he turned the drive over in his fingers.
No way to look at the files here.
He opened the notebook and saw notes and descriptions written in German and cursed again. The only thing rustier than his French right now was his German. John walked into the living room as he flipped through the pages and heard two car doors close outside. He pushed the slats of the blinds apart with a notebook and looked out the window down to the street level. He saw a black sedan parked outside as two raid agents headed inside the building.
All out of time, John thought.
He exited the apartment, closing the broken door behind him mostly out of habit, and headed for the stairs. It was clear to him that they were heading for Matthias's apartment. If he headed down the stairs, he would run into them. John went down one floor and stepped out of the stairwell into the hallway. He heard the sounds of footsteps coming up the stairs as he closed the door to the fourth floor landing behind him. The boot steps and voices of the two men passed by as they continued up the stairs and into the hallway above. He had to move fast. Once they saw the busted door, they would realize immediately that someone was in there. John slipped down the stairs as quietly as he could, heading out the front door into the street. He jogged around the corner of the building and began to walk away at a leisurely pace, blending into the foot traffic in the neighborhood. Lionel Gavreau and Christopher Bessard ascended the stairs leading to Dietrich Byrne's apartment, exiting into a dark hallway with faded carpet, worn thin where they stood. As they headed toward the front door, Gavreau held up a hand, halting the other man. Bessard unholstered his Glock 17 and held it at low ready. Gavreau stepped to the door, examining splintered wood around the lock. He looked at Bessard and nodded, then unholstered his own pistol, a 44 Magnum Smith & Wesson 629. He pushed the door open quietly, and Bessard slid into the room like a ghost. Gavreau moved in right behind, and they cleared the small apartment room by room with practiced precision. Neither man spoke, but both knew exactly what the other was doing at all times.
"Clear,"
Bessard said.
"Clear,"
Gavreau responded. Both men holstered their weapons. Gavreau shook his head in frustration, his hand absently reaching for his jaw again.
"Do you think it was stone?" Bressard asked.
"Yes, I think it was," Gavreau said.
He kicked the grocery bag on the floor.
"These groceries are fresh. I can still smell the bread," Gavreau said, examining the large bite taken out of the baguette.
Bressard let out a sigh. "One of the drawers in the bedroom is smashed apart. Maybe he found something hidden in there." Gavreau walked the apartment, also noting how clean and tidy it was, even after John's hasty search. He stopped in the living room.
"Grab that computer. Maybe we can find something that the American missed," Gavreau said.
"Yes, sir,"
Bressard responded, and went to work, pulling the cables from the wall. Stone was a thorn in his side once again. Gavreau tightened his jaw and let the pain serve to replace his frustration. He turned and swung a boot out hard, launching the chair at the computer desk across the living room.
"Is everything all right, sir?"
Bressard stood with the computer tucked under his arm. Gavreau waved his man off.
"Once we find John Stone, I'm going to make sure we bury him with charges for interfering in our investigation. If the four serpents strike again, Stone will have blood on his hands."
Nizar bin Hashim stood in a courtyard, admiring the French skyline. He didn't hate those that were not believers. His was a bigger mission against a greater enemy. Those in the government that would control its citizens with their heathen ways and no moral compass. A giant of a man, bin Hashim's bodyguard entered the courtyard. Kalik followed close behind. Though the smaller man stood a full two heads shorter than the brute, he showed no fear, physically mimicking his movements and mannerisms. They both stood, waiting for bin Hashim's command, Kalik positioning himself and posturing like the guard. Bin Hashim smiled at the sight of the two, then nodded to the larger man. The bodyguard turned to let Kalik pass and frowned at the sight of the smaller man seeming to mock him. That wasn't the case, however. The guard was told as such. The head of the four serpents summoned this small, strange man personally. Kalik possessed a high-level skill set that allowed him to infiltrate and complete tasks many others would find too difficult. The trade-off was that he always seemed to behave in a peculiar way, imitating physical characteristics he would see in others. He spoke very little, and when he did, he would rarely stay on topic. Bin Hashim accepted his quirks and utilized Kalik's ability to its fullest to further their cause.
"Come in, my friend," Bin Hashim said to the man.
Kalik took two more steps forward, then stopped. They stood in silence for a few awkwardly long moments, when Bin Hashim decided to break the silence.
"The man, Matthias, is he dead?" Bin Hashim asked.
The assassin rocked side to side slightly and nodded.
"Matthias is Dietrich. Dietrich is dead,"
Bin Hashim found the response somewhat confusing, but smiled at the news. Kalik's affirmative nod was all the answer the Serpent leader needed. His words would tend to come out in short, often irrelevant sentences all over the place at times. But physical movements were always the true intent of what Kalik wanted to express.
"This is excellent news, friend," Bin Hashim said,
a genuine smile on his face. Matthias fully funded the operation for the four Serpents, with the promise of riches and power beyond anything he could imagine. His greed was his undoing, as it was for many Westerners in power. The plan Bin Hashim set into motion was the most ambitious idea of any jihad ever attempted. Years in the planning, it had cost so much money to implement that outside sources were necessary to provide the required capital. The trade-off was the elevated risk of exposure, however. Once the pieces of Bin Hashim's plan were in place, the Serpents systematically eliminated anyone involved that hadn't pledged 100% loyalty to the organization. Matthias was the last variable, and with that final loose end tied off, they could now implement their plan in the shadows.
Kalik, my friend, it is time for you to begin the next step.
The assassin nodded.
The doctor. Get the doctor, he said.
Chapter 9.
Los Angeles, California. Parker combed his fingers back through his hair, staring at the progress bar for his search. On the bed next to his desk, AC/DC's Highway to Hell started playing, the ringtone telling him right away who was calling. He tapped the button on his earpiece to answer the call.
"Hey, John, how's everything going?"
Parker asked.
"I could use a little help. I found a key drive and I need to pull all the data. I'm just not able to get into it," John said.
"Sure thing, buddy. Give me a sec," Parker said.
A few clicks on his keyboard and the desktop screen of John's laptop computer appeared on Parker's monitor. Parker's eyes opened wide for a moment at the chaotic clutter of files and folders scattered all over the desktop.
"Ugh, your file structure is an abomination. Don't you use folders?" Parker asked.
"Sue me," John said.
"Are you still using the 8.3 naming convention? This is like staring at the 90s.
"Parker, please," John said. "We don't have time to screw around."
Parker chuckled and moved the cursor over the drive icon on the desktop, double-clicking it. A moment later, the security prompt opened on the window.
Let's see what we have here," Parker said.
Parker's fingers danced over the keyboard, sometimes pausing before resuming the staccato rhythm. The dual monitor setup allowed him to access his own computer files as well as those on John's computer.
"Your corporate shelfware is no match for my digital wizardry," he mumbled.
"What?"
"Oh, nothing," Parker said. "I mean, ta-da!"
He flourished his hands, knowing John wouldn't be able to see the gesture. The key drive icon opened to reveal a list of folders with cryptic names. Nothing stood out to Parker as he scanned through them. The arrow on John's desktop began to move toward one of the folders. Parker chuckled, imagining John being too impatient and opening the files on his own now. The first folder opened, displaying a list of text files. Again, nothing stood out. One by one, John searched each of the folders on the drive, occasionally battling for control of the computer with Parker. The programmer finally relented, letting John take point.
"Looks like a bunch of text files," John said.
"Hang on, John," Parker said, retaking control of John's computer. "Let me try something."
Parker copied the contents of the flash drive to his own computer.
"I cast detect magic," he said,
running a subroutine that scanned through all the text files, looking for patterns like recurring names and dates. After a couple of minutes, the program started populating a growing list to display its findings.
"I see names listed here, with dates and euro amounts. These look like payments between two parties. I mean, it looks pretty innocuous, but given that it wasn't a secret drive..."
John made a sound like an impatient grunt, interrupting Parker's monologue.
"Right, sorry," Parker said.
Parker clicked a few keys and dragged a window around until John could see Parker's desktop displayed on his own laptop.
"Like I said, nothing out of the ordinary here, unless these are payments for some type of nefarious purpose," Parker said.
John sat at the desk of a different hotel room and scanned the names on the list. He looked for anyone linked to Matthias Kepler or any of his known aliases.
Parker, can you tell if any of the bank accounts listed here are somehow connected with more than one person on this list? John asked.
There isn't enough information, Parker said. All I've got are the last four digits of each account, and in some cases, the name of the bank.
John sat back in his seat.
Why would Kepler have this information?
He's a middleman, a financier, Parker said.
John focused his attention on the recipients, scanning down the list until one near the middle grabbed his attention.
Wait, C. Broussard. I recognize that name. He's one of the rate guys. Gavreau's second in command, John said, sitting up straighter.
Hold on. I'll check him out, Parker said.
John saw windows opening and text flying across the view of Parker's desktop on his laptop. He was in awe of how fast Parker was moving and processing the information he found. A picture showed Christopher Broussard's identification photo and career credentials.
That's him, John said. Give me everything you can about him.
You think he's dirty? Parker asked. I mean, what if Raid is using him as an undercover agent to infiltrate the Four Serpents?
Under his real name? Do it, Parker. We can't take any chances.
Chapter 10. Raid HQ.
The Raid team computer tech finished connecting all of the cables to Matthias Kepler's computer and powering it up.
How old is this thing? Broussard asked as several minutes passed.
After a few more diagnostic screens flashed, the operating system started, greeting the team with a login prompt.
Okay, it might be a while before I can get in here, the tech said.
How long? Gavreau asked.
Well, if we could guess his password, not long at all. Did you happen to find any clues that would point us in the right direction?
Gavreau grew impatient.
No, nothing. Just do what you can to get in there.
All right, it might be a while, the tech said,
repeating himself. The man rolled his chair to another computer and pulled up a command prompt screen.
I'll be back, Broussard said.
Gavreau grunted his acknowledgement, staying focused on the tech and Kepler's computer. Broussard exited the room and made his way to the stairwell. He took the stairs instead of the elevator, heading for the blind spot he knew about in the building's security camera coverage. Once out from under the digital eye of the surveillance system, he pulled a SIM card from a hidden pocket and swapped the one in his cell phone. Broussard continued down to the front exit of the building. He walked outside and down the street to a nearby bench. Once there, he sat down and lit up a cigarette before sending a message on his phone, attaching the digital files he had on John Stone. Broussard casually finished his cigarette, grinding the butt out with his boot, and walked back into the Raid headquarters. He went up the stairs, switching his SIM card out in the same blind spot, and headed back to the IT room. Gavreau exited the door as he opened it, so Broussard followed the commander.
It's going to be a while, Gavreau said, the frustration in his voice evident.
Is there anything you need now? Broussard asked.
No, thank you. I'll be in my office. Call me if the techs find anything.
Yes, sir.
Broussard watched the Raid commander head into his office, closing the door behind him. He then headed into the room with the computer tech. Umari Malouf grinned as he sat on the floor next to his children. The smile on his face beamed, made brighter by the wonderful scent wafting out from the kitchen where his wife prepared their supper. Umari's son and daughter laughed and rolled around as he joined them.
"What are we playing now?"
he asked. His five-year-old son jumped on Umari's back as he leaned over to tickle his daughter.
"You're a horsey now," his son squealed.
He laughed as he caught his breath for a moment, then began to crawl around the living room, whinnying and neighing. Umari's daughter, only 3 1/2, started to walk in front of him, holding an imaginary treat to lead him.
"Carrot? Want carrot?" she asked.
He followed her around for a bit, then without warning, rose up, waving his hands in the air like a horse standing on its hind legs. His son screamed and wrapped his arms around his father's neck, squealing with laughter. A cell phone on the end table buzzed. Umari trotted like a horse on his hands and knees, taking his son to the couch.
"Okay, son. Horsey needs a break," he said, bucking his son onto the couch.
"Me too,"
his daughter said. Chuckling, he swung his daughter onto his back and bucked her off gently onto the couch next to her brother. Umari stood and picked up his phone. His smile faltered slightly as he read the incoming message. He spoke to his son, careful not to let his smile change now.
"Take your sister to your room.
and play until dinner is ready.
Yes, Daddy,
his son said. He grabbed his sister's hand and led her down the hall. Amari read the message from his contact in Raid, frowning when he saw that they found out about Matthias, securing a computer from his residence. He skimmed over the information about the American, John Stone. Would this man be a threat to the upcoming plans? He closed the message, then dialed a number on his phone. After two rings, someone on the other end answered.
It's Amari. I need to speak with him, he said.
We will call you back.
Before Amari could say anything, the line disconnected. He sat on the couch and waited for a few agonizing minutes. The ringing phone startled Amari, snapping him out of his haze. He knew that the line would be secured on the other end.
What do you want? Azar bin Hashim asked.
There is a complication with Matthias. Raid has taken the computer from his apartment, Amari said.
Are you positive?
Yes. Our contact has confirmed.
Bin Hashim sighed on the other end, then silence. Amari wiped a bead of sweat from his brow, wanting to say something, anything, to break the silence. He feared it was a judgment of his fate for this news.
Very well. We will have to move up the timetable now, Bin Hashim said. Get your part ready, Maloof. Do not fail me in this mission.
It will be done, Amari answered.
Minutes stretched out, feeling like hours before Parker sighed over the speakerphone. There is no evidence of wrongdoing that can be pinned on this Broussard guy, he said.
You can't find anything connecting Broussard and Kepler? John asked.
I found records of money transferred to his account, which is innocent enough since I don't know who sent the payments. But given the size of the transfers and Matthias's dubious nature...
I have to tell Gavreau, John said, interrupting.
Tell him what? We don't have much here.
This is too much of a coincidence. We can't risk having a rat in that task force, John answered.
We?
Now isn't the time to worry about jurisdictions, John said. The four serpents are still out there. They could strike again at any time, and right now, Raid could be compromised.
Yeah, I guess you're right, Parker said. John pulled the small USB key drive from his laptop, stuffed it into a pocket, and grabbed Kepler's leather-bound notebook.
See if you can find anything that could tell me where to go next, John said.
I'll see what I can do, but Kepler was just a money man. Not sure I'll find any specific evidence, Parker said.
Run the rest of the team, Parker. Make sure there are no other surprises.
The entire team? Parker asked.
Yes. Especially Gavreau,
John said, before ending the call and heading out the door.
Chapter 11. Raid HQ, France.
It was past 8 p.m., and most of the personnel in the office had already gone home. Gavreau spent the majority of the afternoon and early evening at his desk or in the computer rooms, bothering the techs handling Kepler's computer. He finally stood up from his chair and stretched before turning out the lights and closing his door as he left the office.
"Good night, Diana," he said as he passed the reception desk.
"Good night, sir,"
she replied. Gavreau headed for the parking lot, pulling the keys from his pocket to unlock his car. He reached for the handle to the driver's side door when someone spoke behind him.
"We need to talk," the deep voice came from the shadows.
Gavreau turned to look, pivoting with his feet, to square up with the voice behind him. A head turn alone would leave him vulnerable. The American, John Stone, stepped into the golden glow from an overhead light. In one smooth motion, Gavreau had his Smith & Wesson 629 drawn from the holster, its sights centered on the American's chest. John's hands rose up to shoulder height, palms forward to show he was unarmed.
"Easy. I come in peace," he said.
"You are under arrest, Stone. Keep your hands up," Gavreau said.
The two men stared at each other in a tense standoff, John waiting to see what Gavreau would do next, and the raid commander playing out the possibilities of John resisting arrest in his head. It was John that broke the silent tension.
"I have information you need that's bigger than this," John said,
gesturing to the pistol in Gavreau's hand.
"You can tell me everything you need to when we're back inside the headquarters," Gavreau said, reaching for his radio with his free hand.
"It's about Broussard,"
John said, looking him in the eye. Gavreau froze. His grip on the pistol tightened, and he stared daggers at the American.
"What did you do to Christopher?"
he asked, venom dripping from his words.
"He's fine,"
John said, to assure Gavreau.
but I think he's been compromised.
Do not dare question my men, he said through gritted teeth.
I have something to show you, John said.
Though he was not as muscular as John, Gavreau was just as tall. The tension permeated the space between the two, a near tangible presence.
You have 10 seconds to convince me, Stone.
Gavreau's hand lowered from his radio.
Broussard has been receiving payments from someone. Matthias Kepler was handling the transfers, John said.
I hope you do not think baseless accusations are going to sway me, the raid commander said. His anger made his French accent thicker.
John nodded and moved one hand slowly toward his pocket. Gavreau's pistol remained firmly aimed at John. He pulled the key drive from his pocket and tossed it casually toward the raid commander. Gavreau caught it with his free hand, the heavy revolver never wavering.
What is on this? He asked, holding up the drive, eyes still fixed on John.
I got it from the apartment of Dietrich Byrne. That was just one of Matthias Kepler's many aliases. Those files are Kepler's financial records, John said. But Sard's name is in there, multiple times. I think he's been working for someone else for a while now. I'm sorry, Gavreau.
How do I know you are telling the truth? Gavreau asked.
I didn't have to come find you, but this was too important to let go.
Gavreau paused, then nodded slightly. John pulled the notebook from his back pocket and held it out.
I found this with the drive. I don't speak German, so it's no good to me. Maybe it will help your investigation.
Okay, I will look at them. Give me your number and the address where you're staying, and I will get in contact with you, Gavreau said.
With all due respect, I'd rather not. I'll get in touch with you later, John said.
John figured they would know the first hotel he was staying in after the hospital incident. He had to move. Didn't want them to know which hotel he had chosen after that. Gavreau raised his .44 Magnum for a second, contemplating just arresting Stone on the spot. John remained calm throughout the entire encounter. He finally relented and lowered the revolver. Gavreau gave him a short nod, and John backed away into the shadows. He holstered his pistol and turned the key drive over in his fingers.
Chris.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.